Hello, welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. My guest today, John Badham, is one of Hollywood's finest directors. But he's also shared sort of his experiences with other directors, be it Richard Donner or any of the others you can think of. They are here in this book. But the book is called John Badham on Directing. It's published by Michael Wiese Productions. Welcome, John.
Hi. Glad to be here.
Again. It's been a long time because we were there with the first book. Call me, I'm in the trailer.
I'll be in my trailer.
Yes. But you've changed, as a matter of fact, in writing this book about how a director works with actors and many ways.
Mm-hmm.
And today, I don't think you would say, I'll be in my trailer.
Well, sometimes that's what the actor says.
Yeah.
I'll be in my trailer. And how do you deal with that? And this book deals a lot with, why do actors not trust directors? What have directors done to make actors not trust them?
Well, those are the first five chapters of this book.
Right.
Let's tell our friends some of the reasons.
Well, usually a lot of our modern directors have been raised with cameras in their hands since they were little.
Yes.
They understand all the mechanics of making film. They know how to work every camera ever made, every video camera. They know all the lights, the sound equipment, the grip equipment, the dollies. They don't know human beings.
Yeah.
And human beings have this annoying fact of way of being human and doing things that you don't expect them to do. And how do you deal with that? Well, that's a life experience.
Well, you do a story here about working with Goldie Hawn. Where she's so afraid of doing something, you have Dawn, her understudy, do it. Then she does. She loved every minute of it and said, "Let's do it again."
Well, she was afraid of roller coasters. And we had a scene where she and Mel Gibson are riding a big roller coaster up in Vancouver. And on the day of shooting, she chooses to tell me she's terrified of roller coasters. Not a word before then. And the choice was to get in there and try to bully her into it, or see if we could just find a way to ease her into it.
Yeah.
And acknowledge that she was afraid and say, okay, it is scary, but maybe we can find a way to do it.
Yeah.
And eventually, after we had shot some with her photo double, who did look a lot like Goldie, we got her into the roller coaster just to do what was going to be like a 20, 30 foot long pull of the roller coaster almost on flat ground. And Mel Gibson has got her in his arms. She's kind of sitting there, and as they're getting ready to go, I can see him talking to her, and he's saying, well, you know, it's kind of good, it's fun, I've been around a couple of times, it's not bad, and I see her nodding her head and nodding, and I just got a sense of something, and I wave my hand to the assistant director, who waved to the guy who started the ride of the roller coaster. He pulls the lever, off the thing goes, and she came back. Her eyes were big as saucers, and she said, that was great, wow. Well, she was proud of herself for having done it.
Yeah.
But part of the point was that we eased her into it. We acknowledged her fear and let her get there and didn't make fun of her or try to bully her into it. And it's often a way to work with people.
As well as some of the suggestions here of working with actors, film folk could learn from it too, because some of your directors say, look, let me ask you questions. How are you? What have you done before? Where have you? Oh, yeah, that was so that you show the actor you're interested in their person.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yes. We often make the mistake, I'm saying directors, of treating actors like robots.
Yeah.
They come on the set and you kind of flip a switch and they start acting. But of course they are nervous, scared people. even if they've been doing it for a long time, even if they're pros, they still get nervous about it. And they need to be treated with a little bit of love, a little bit of care. Yeah. And it takes a lot more care than some of us would like to give.
Of course, sometimes it's hard for a director who's working on television where time is of the essence.
Yes, of course.
Yeah.
And I'm doing a lot of television now, so I can say with confidence that you can still treat them with some care and respect and love, even on these horrendous schedules that we have for television, because there's always lighting time, there's always makeup time, there's all of this time. And as one actor, Rod Steiger, said to me, you know, we sit around, we wait for all of this lighting and makeup and everything to happen, and all of a sudden, with no preparation, they turn to me, Rod Steiger, and they say, "The magic, please."
Yeah.
And, you know, I deserve the same respect as the makeup person.
But you said, too, always get to the stage 45 minutes early, because that allows you the time to sort of make the rounds and make everyone feel comfortable.
Yes, when they're sitting in the makeup trailer at 6:30 in the morning, and you have a 7:30, you, the director, have a 7:30 call, you come wandering in, let's go. But if you've gotten there 6:45, 7 o'clock with them in the makeup trailer, that's where everybody literally lets their hair down.
Yeah.
You know, they're bare face, they have no makeup on, they're sort of very vulnerable. It's a good time to talk about what are we doing today and how do you feel about today.
And also, when you've ended as a director saying, cut, print, they're going to look at you and say, how was it? They're not asking, really, how was it? They want to, how was I?
That's right. Yes, they don't want to know how was it in general. How was I is the way that they, you know, they're just not going to say that.
Yeah.
But, well, no, I take that back. Rod Steiger would say that. He'd say, I don't care about that. How was I?
None of the nonsense. Get to the cut. But you also say directors have a tendency to overtalk.
Yes. Yes, that's one of our worst faults, is that we start to explain something, and instead of finding two or three key words, we sort of start babbling on. Well, what happens? Watch the actor's eyes when you do this. After about 10 seconds, it just starts to glaze over.
Yeah.
And they're not really listening to you. They're thinking about, I wonder what my agent's doing. I wonder how the dog is that I bought today that's in the trailer. What are we having for lunch? They haven't heard a word. But if you can say, in this scene, I need you to convince this person. I need you to persuade this person. I need you to seduce her. You know, one or two words, and that they can work with.
Yeah.
They don't want a huge explanation. And in fact, you can't act that.
You quote one of the actors turning to the director and saying, almost like, I don't understand what you're even talking about.
Right, right. Yeah. Yeah, because as we start babbling on, I'm afraid that was me. And it was, God bless him, Bill Bixby, who turned to me and said that.
Yeah.
And I had made the mistake of babbling on. And, of course, he just lost the thread, and I probably was making no sense anyway.
Yeah. Oh, I don't think so. But the difference between you, can you look at yourself now how you direct as opposed to when you began?
Oh, yes, absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. I think I was a lot more afraid of actors, and even though I'd been working with actors and been an actor myself, just the whole job of directing is hard, and it can take you years and years to get where you feel comfortable with
you
actors.
You mentioned a man who really, I don't think he was that much of a director as he was a coach, Jeff Corey.
Oh, bless him, yes.
And Jeff, I wasn't an actor, actress. I was playing tennis, and he was given to me as a partner. He is the man who knew how to bring out the best in you.
Oh, good.
Yeah.
Good. I know a lot of his students, and of course I've directed him and worked with him. We used to direct on Night Gallery together. And And his students all speak of how clever he was at coaching and bringing out the best in them. I'm so glad you said that.
I thought I've got to mention this man because he had a kindness that made you do better.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, he had a way of saying things that maybe other people could say the same thing and would get you mad.
Yeah.
But he could say it in a way that would make you laugh and hear the truth of it.
And maybe hit a better ball. Tell me about booby traps.
Oh, my God. Any in particular?
Well, you have the picture of Nikita here. I wish I could. It was big enough to hold up, and I know you've been directing that.
Mm-hmm.
What has happened in that?
Well, in there, you'll find things that happen that you don't expect, and how do you deal with that? How do you deal with it when the actor doesn't show up that day?
Yeah.
You know, these
Or how about when you're talking here about somebody on a horse and they fall off and have to be taken to the hospital?
Oh, that's one of my nightmare days.
Yeah.
Again, on Night Gallery as a very young director. And knowing that I wanted to see Barbara Parkins riding a horse.
Yeah.
And not thinking that she might not be good at it. And I said, are you good at, you know, riding?
Yeah.
Oh, I love riding horses.
Yeah.
I was born on a horse. Well, my mistake to take that literally.
Yeah.
And she has to come riding by the camera very fast. And so she comes riding by, and then she stops about 30 feet beyond the camera, and sitting there just proceeds to go off the horse. And the booby trap is never letting your actors do stunts unless you are 1,000% convinced that they can do it. Because
and poor Barbara, she was replaced by Susan Strasberg.
By Susan Strasberg the next day. And it was, you know, everybody blamed me, and rightfully so, because I should have known better than to, you know, have somebody doing their own stunts.
Well, except that happens to every director, I think, at some point.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. The other was in booby trapping, because it's sort of funny in a way, is with Richard Dreyfuss.
Well,
whose life is it anyway?
Well, it actually was in a film called Stakeout.
Uh-huh.
And he's playing a cop. Well, he played the cop because he said, I've never played a cop before. I've always wanted to do very physical stuff. But then he would also say, you know, sometime else, I'm terrible at physical stuff. You know, I run funny.
And he did.
And so we have to have a scene where he jumps over a fence and lands in somebody's backyard, and it's a little fence.
Oh, God, well, yes.
I know that he can't jump over the fence, and so I don't think that, but I need to have him kind of land on the ground. So I put him on a little box, you know, a little apple box only about a foot off the ground, and have him kind of jump into frame. And that's simple enough, right? How hard can that be? And he goes, jump out, and bam, down. He twists his ankle. He goes on the ground screaming like crazy. And we're out of business for a day. And you think, there's almost nothing that you can safely do with an actor. You know, driving a car is like a nightmare. So you have to check these things out. You have to be so careful.
That was interesting when you say about driving a car, because you did do the scene with John Travolta where you said it was wrong in the car, talking about
Saturday Night Fever
with the girl, and it was played much better with them just being quiet there and not moving. It's interesting. I watched the movie last night. It was on television.
Okay.
On Encore.
Oh, yes.
And it was really, you were so right. I mean, all of the scenes like that, it's a great film anyhow.
Thank you. Thank you, Encore. Thank you for running it. My business manager thanks you.
God bless residuals.
Yes.
Yes.
This was an interesting thing that I had to learn the hard way.
Yeah.
Which is that when you have a scene where people get emotional, they physically want to stop and not be walking around, not be doing other things. They have to, if they're involved in an activity like cooking, they're going to just stop doing that.
Yeah.
If they're walking down the street, they're going to stop. So here we are trying to do a scene where they're driving in a car and having a big argument, which does happen, of course.
Yeah.
But the actors were just couldn't get it together because it was so distracting. And I saw the dailies the next morning at 6:30, and I went, oh, this is terrible. And we went back to the set, and before we even started our regular day's work, we stood them on the sidewalk and said, do the scene.
Yeah.
And we shot it in like 20 minutes, the whole thing over again. It was wonderful, great emotion and everything, just standing there the next morning. And so one of the things I teach my students is if you've got people doing walk and talk scenes, when they get to that emotional stuff, you've got to expect that they're going to stop, and you have to be ready to shoot that.
You talked, too, about Kevin Costner, American Flyer.
Yes. Well, that's interesting because he was on a bicycle a lot.
Yeah.
And he was his best acting when he was on the bicycle because he was totally focused on being a good racer. And when he was not on the bicycle, it was worrying about this scene or that scene or this piece of dialogue or that piece of dialogue and say, well, let's get him on the bike.
Yeah.
That's what we need.
Yeah. There's a point, too. Do you use playback, the video that you're watching it while they're doing it?
Well, it's ubiquitous. It's on every set. Everybody seems to have it now.
Mm-hmm.
I try not to watch it because it's sort of like watching television. You get into this sort of passive experience.
Yeah.
And so I'll look at it to see if they've got the shot right.
Yeah.
But then basically I get close to the actors and pay attention to them.
Except for the cameraman who said, will you please move, John, because you're shaking the...
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. They will not let me sit on the dolly.
Yeah.
Because I get, you know, involved, and then the dolly starts to shake and the camera starts to shake. So I've been banned from all dollies.
John, when you look back, what's your favorite film?
Well, that's kind of a hard one because there are a lot of favorites, even in films that maybe didn't work very well. But, you know, War Games is a wonderful film with a lot of... very funny stuff in it and a lot of, you know, kind of deep stuff about war and, you know, and even Invasion of Privacy and the internet, the raw beginnings of the internet.
Yeah. In doing these films, do you find yourself at a different stage in your life and therefore having a different reaction, or what's going on in your life at that time?
Well, that certainly makes a big difference.
Yeah.
When I recently saw the original version of Saturday Night Fever in the theater at Paramount, they ran it for all the employees, I thought, this is very rude and very sexist and racist and my goodness, this is so raw. That's what we set out to make, was a very raw picture. But I was shocked myself at what have I done.
Well, I have to tell you, that was true. Last night, when they go to the car where the guy has been with his girl, and your show is behind, I thought, oh, I don't remember to see. And then at the end, he says, by the way, honey, what's your name?
Yes.
those are the small things where you say, do you change scripts much?
Well, in that one, we changed the script a lot.
Yeah.
It was a wonderful script, but I let the actors ad-lib if they had something funny to say. My feeling is you can always go back to the original dialogue if they say something that's inappropriate or just stupid, and let them try.
Yeah.
And they did a lot. John Travolta ad-libbed all over the place, But he understood that character so well that he made it five times funnier than it already was. It was already funny.
Yeah.
And kind of deep. But he would find, you know, cuckoo ways to say things that were so delightful.
Yeah, he really, that made him a star, as you know.
Yes.
That part. But even watching it, the film holds up.
Mm. Yeah. Well, thank you. Thank you.
Well, all I can say is I did enjoy that. See it before you shoot it. Do you have a storyboard?
Well, I believe in storyboards for action sequences. And then it's very efficient and it's very clever. You can see exactly what you need.
Yeah.
It's so expensive to shoot action scenes that you better have worked it out in detail beforehand. On the other hand, you don't want to shoot dialogue scenes.
Yeah.
You don't want to storyboard dialogue scenes because you and the actors are going to work something out that's probably different than you and the storyboard artist drawing sketches of little talking heads, which is kind of silly.
But sometimes these storyboards are really like works of art. I mean, I hope you have kept them and framed some of them.
They do some beautiful work, and it depends on how much time the artist has. If they have to do a quick job for me for an episode of Nikita, then they're going to do a quick sketch. But some of those are pretty good.
Yeah.
And then if it's a big movie, then they're going to come out with, you know, Degas, Monet, big watercolors, beautiful things.
And the section, what happens next? How do you then change what is on a screen or on the script that isn't playing?
Well, you've got to find out, you know, what you're supposed to be trying to do in the first place.
Yeah.
You kind of have to go back to square one. It's not playing, but why is it not playing?
Yeah.
You know, what's the thing that, you know, where is the actor going? What are they trying to do in the scene?
Do you find that out when you are rehearsing them?
Yes.
Yeah.
That's usually...
That's the luxury a director doesn't always have, though.
Yes. Yeah. Hopefully, you've figured a lot out in the script stage.
Yeah.
And maybe you've cornered all those problems. But when the actor comes in, they bring a whole fresh point of view to it.
Yeah.
And they will see things that you never thought of.
Yeah.
And you go, oh, my gosh, well, let's work this out. So I like having the writer on the set with me because I can say, Bill, come over here.
Yeah.
Help me out with this. And actors do respect writers.
Yeah.
They really so that the writer comes in and can explain what he or she was thinking of when they were at their word processor, then the actor will go, oh, I get it, I understand.
Yeah.
And if they don't understand, then they kind of work the line out together.
John, are you still a professor out at Chapman?
I am.
Yeah.
I am.
How
I teach
three
courses every semester.
Uh-huh.
And then when I have somewhere to go. In October, I'm going to do a show called Supernatural. And so a couple of my friends...
Is that science fiction?
It is.
Yeah.
It's all kind of horror science fiction stuff.
Yeah.
So I'll have some friends that will take over for me for 3 weeks.
Yeah.
And I also let my students participate because I have started a blog on the show, and they will be able to see what I'm doing, and I'll give them the script to read and make them stage scenes for me so they can see what's happening in real time.
I don't think there's another school that's doing that. I think that's a brilliant idea.
Well, they love doing it, and it's nice that I have the opportunity to be able to do those shows and then kind of share it with the students.
That is just great. And you're also, what is the name of the school? I know it's Chapman University, but the name of your division?
School, it's the Dodge College of Film and Media Arts.
Yeah.
And Larry and Christina Dodge gave over $20 million to the school. So they can have it named whatever they like.
Right. Which means that you have the best equipment to work with.
We have wonderful equipment.
Yeah.
You know, and the most up-to-date kind of things, and we've gone into 3D and motion capture, and you know, the students can try any of the newest techniques. I'm working with them on the most basic techniques, because I think that's often the part they skip over. They go, let's go right to 3D. And you go, wait a minute. Yeah. Let's just talk about two people sitting in, on a sofa talking to each other.
Do you make them also learn how to write a screenplay, how to write a scene?
They will. They will do a lot of that.
Yeah.
And they'll be taking courses where they'll have to write a short script and direct it, too. And see how that works.
And this is all undergrad?
And graduate students.
And graduate. Oh. Pleasure to see you, John. Don't wait, what is it, since 2007? Don't wait so long.
Oh, okay. Now
and
I'll have to write
anybody
another
who would like to see that particular show that we did earlier, go to Claremont Graduate University Digital Library, the Peter Drucker Institute. You'll get Connie Martinson Talks books there. We've donated 2,000 shows. But put John Badham's name and then where they have like a little question mark, nip it, and you will get to see what we had to say then and how much younger we all were. But support your local library. Go in, take out a card. That's how they get funding. Take a child with you. Get them their first library card, e-books or no e-books. They will never forget where they were when they got their first library card. And they'll also learn, if you take a book out, you return it in the condition you took it, as well as when it was due. But that's all just part of being a grown-up. So support your library, go in, and also they will have videos that you can take out. Well, we'll see you next time. Thank you very much, John.
Thank you.